Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 23 says, "Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised." Let us hold fast the profession of our faith. Profession in the Greek also means confession, or what you say, your faith speaking. And then it says, without wavering. You may remember what James said in James chapter 1. If you lack wisdom, ask God, who giveth liberally to all men and upbraideth not. But James said, let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. And then he explained, he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven of the wind and tossed. Let not that man think he'll receive anything. He started out talking about wisdom, but now he's talking about anything. And so wavering will cause you to miss out on what you're asking for, whether it's wisdom or whether it's anything. He that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven of the wind and tossed. And the wave is up, the wave is down. The wave is up, the wave is down. The wavering is one moment you're in your heart and the next moment you're in your head. Then one moment you're believing God's word in your heart, the next moment you're wondering in your head. I think about that man in Mark chapter 9 that said, "Lord, I believe, help thou mine unbelief." I believe that's what he was doing, is having a struggle with his mind. I believe you, but my mind is bothering me. Help thou mine unbelief. And people today need to watch that. Keep the faith active in your heart and don't yield to the thoughts in your mind and don't consider the circumstances. Abraham didn't consider his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He didn't stagger. Now, this is Romans chapter 4. The Bible says there, around verse 18, he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief. Now, it says that he had faith. He's strong in faith. Where did the faith come from? Abraham had faith. Where did it come from? Well, it says there it came from the promise. It's what God said. So shall thy seed be, and that was spoken according to that which was spoken. So he heard the word of God. That which was spoken, the promise. The word of God is what brings you faith. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Once you have the word of God, now you have the opportunity to look at circumstances. And circumstances sometimes will tell you it's not true, it's not working, it's not happening. And you can either believe what's in your heart from the word of God, or you can look at the circumstances. And Abraham considered not his own body, now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. Susan may be putting that up around Romans chapter 4, around verse 17, verse 18. It says he staggered not. Isn't that the same thing as he didn't waver? Isn't that exactly the same thing? He didn't waver. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in what? Faith. Where'd that faith come from? He heard. He had the promise. He heard what was spoken. So shall thy seed be. He heard the word of God. And so he didn't stagger at that promise. He was strong in faith, giving glory to God first. Before he had it, before he saw it, before he felt it, before he could say, here it is. He was giving glory to God first. And being fully persuaded, God promised it. He's able to perform it. And just bless God, that's it. And he called things which be not as though they were. Romans 4, 17. He called things which be not as though they were. That's one of the hardest things sometimes to get some people to do, because they want to talk the circumstances. Abraham didn't consider his own body. He didn't talk his dead body. He didn't talk his wife's dead body. That means the parts that would produce results were dead. Now, he wasn't dead, but that part of his body was dead. The life creation-producing part of his body and her body didn't function anymore. You're going to be the father of multitudes, many nations. Well, the part of his body and the part of her body that would cooperate with that was dead. But he didn't stagger at the promise. He didn't consider his own body. He gave glory to God. He was fully persuaded. God promised it. He's able to perform it. And he got his mouth in line with the Word of God. He talked the same as the Word of God was talking. God said, your name is Abraham, the father of multitudes. He talked that way too. He called things which be not as though they were. Now to stagger at that, James said, wavering, staggering, let not that man think he'll receive anything. Not just wisdom, but anything. So Hebrews 10:23 is hold fast. You'll have opportunities to let it go. I've learned by experience, not just by the word of God, but experience. You know, you'll learn both ways. That if I will stay with it, and this is something that I continually tell people and encourage people, don't quit. Stay with it. Yeah, I know how it feels to want to give up. I know how it feels to want to quit. I know how it feels to say this has taken a long time. But stay with it. God is faithful. God is faithful. Stay with it. Don't quit. It'll produce results. If you take a step forward and you take a step back and then you take a step forward and you take a step back, you'll never get there. Wavering will cause you to miss out. It's like a wave of the sea driven of the wind and tossed. You're up, you're down. You're forward, you're back. You're forward, you're back. Your heart, your head. You're up, you're down. You're wonderful, you're doubting. God's wonderful. I don't know why it's taken so long. Oh, thank you, Lord. Wonder why God's not listening. Oh, me, oh, my. Oh, praise God. Why aren't you hearing me? You're up, you're down. Well, you're not going to get it. Come on. James said, let not that man even think he's going to get anything. Well, I just believe in God's timing. When he gets ready. James didn't say anything was in God's timing. He said, if you'll waver, you're not going to get it. Has nothing to do with God's will. Has nothing to do with God's timing. Has nothing to do with God getting ready. He said, if you waver, let not that man think he'll receive anything. Now, if you take two steps forward and one back, and then two steps forward and one back, and two steps forward and one back, you'll eventually get there. But you're getting there a little slower than you could. Well, stay with it. At least you're doing that. Stay with it. If you catch yourself doubting, then get off of it. It's like Peter in Matthew 14 when he was beginning to sink. He could have caught it and said, no, Lord, you told me to come and I'm coming. And he could have stepped back on the water. I've caught myself beginning to sink. And so you can catch it. I've got two steps forward, but I took a step back. But I caught it, and I'm not going to go another step back. I'm going to go back forward. If you'll stay with it, God's faithful, you'll get results. So that if everything was instant, we wouldn't even need these scriptures. And yet people by the multitudes are trying to get everything instant, and when it's not instant, they think God doesn't want them to have it. And they'll go to another meeting, and they'll go to another meeting, and they're trying to find somebody to pray the prayer of faith. They're trying to find somebody who's got a special gift. They're trying to find somebody who's got a special anointing. I'm trying to find somebody who's got my answer. He's got my healing. He's got the anointing. I'm looking for someone. And they'll keep going from here and there, and they're trying to get it instant. And for the brand new baby Christian, God will do some things instant. God will do some things even for sinners who aren't even saved. Evangelistically, he will do some things. But after we've heard the word of God, after we grow or should grow, more is expected. And verses like this are a part of our maturity, where we learn to stand. Ephesians chapter 6, having done all, stand. We learn how to stand our ground. We learned what to do in the evil day, to withstand. We learn how to hold fast, like this is saying in Hebrews 10:23. Without wavering, we learn how to hold fast to our profession of faith without wavering. I believe God, it shall be, even as it was told me. I'm not moved by the circumstances. I'm not moved by the events of the day. I'm not moved by what's happening in the world. I'm not moved. The word of God is what moves me. And you learn by maturity and by growth and development. So this tells us to hold fast. If it was instant, you wouldn't need to hold fast. Hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. Why? He's faithful. Isn't this saying, stay with it? Is that what it's saying? Stay with it. Don't quit. Stay with it. Hold fast. Why? He's faithful. He's faithful. Well, it looks like I'm not getting it. Hold fast. He's faithful. Well, it looks like it's not happening. Hold fast. He's faithful. He promised it. He's faithful. So hold fast. Keep, what does it mean? Keep saying the same thing. Keep saying what you've been saying. Keep saying what your faith in God's word has been saying. Don't say the circumstances. Say what God's word says. Don't say how you feel, what you think. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 says to cast down imaginations and bring every thought into captivity. Is that right? The Bible there in 2 Corinthians 10 calls these strongholds. Well, strongholds are not out there in the heavens somewhere where the devil's made camp, you know, and he's sending the troops from his area of a stronghold. The stronghold in 2 Corinthians 10 is referring to your mind. The thoughts in your mind, the imaginations in your mind. One wrong thought can hold you in captivity. One wrong thought can hold you in bondage. If you think the Lord did it, that'll hold you in bondage. If you think it's all in His timing and it's up to Him, that'll hold you in bondage, because you're not going to receive by faith. If you think it's all up to God and you don't have to do anything, that'll hold you in bondage. If you think the Lord's paying you back, if you think the Lord is punishing you, if you think that you've missed it and it's your sin or the sin of the world or the sin of this land or your neighborhood sin or the county or the state, the devil can present a thought to you and that one thought will hold you in bondage. Cast down imaginations and bring in every thought into the obedience of Christ. Bring in into captivity every thought into the obedience of Christ. These are strongholds that I'm to pull down. I'm to pull down the strongholds from my mind. The thoughts that come to my mind that will try to get me out of the Word of God and to stop believing in the Word of God that it's working. Well, there's some reason, a sense of unrighteousness or a sense of failure. I failed the Lord, and so I'm not going to get it. The devil will tell you that. He'll tell you that. You're not worthy. You've done something wrong. You failed the Lord, and you're not going to get it. The devil will tell you that. Well, these strongholds in your mind are to be pulled down. What do I mean, pull them down? Cast down the imaginations. What do I mean, cast them down? Get them out of your mind. Replace them with other thoughts. Stop thinking those thoughts and start thinking other thoughts. Stop thinking those negative thoughts and start thinking on the Word of God. Amen. Is that right or not? And so pull down the strongholds, cast down the imaginations, bring the thoughts into captivity. Philippians chapter 4 says, whatsoever things are true and just and honest and pure and lovely and of good report, if there's any virtue, if there's any praise, think on these things. That's Philippians chapter 4. And around verse 8? Whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report. I'm quoting it, but she puts it up. It says, if there's any virtue, if there's any praise, think on that. What am I supposed to think on? Somebody tells you something and it's true. Well, is it virtuous? Not everything true, it needs to be thought on. Can somebody say amen? All of these things need to qualify. It needs to be true, but it also needs to be honest. It needs to be just. It needs to be pure. It needs to be lovely. Is it lovely? It needs to be of good report. It needs to have virtue and praise. That's where your mind is to be stayed. Replace the thoughts that are negative with the thoughts that are positive. And I'll tell you tonight, I'll tell you again, it's a fight. We fight the good fight. It's a fight. We've got an enemy, and he's walking about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour, and we're to resist him steadfast in the faith. And one of the tactics that he uses, the weapons of his warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God, or ours are not carnal, mighty through God. to the pulling down of strongholds, but Ephesians chapter 6, that it says that he has the wiles of the devil. We're to stand against the wiles of the devil, the strategies, the wiles of the devil. He has wiles. He has strategies. And, well, one way is thoughts. He'll present a thought to your mind. Somebody say amen. Is this true or not? He'll present a thought to your mind, and the design of that is to rob you of the victory, to rob you of the blessing, to rob you of the faith. He wants to counter the faith of God's word with some thought in your mind or some circumstance that he tries to get you to dwell on, to focus on, to look at. Look at these circumstances. And he wants you to consider them. Abraham didn't consider their circumstances. Peter did. He saw the wind boisterous and beginning to sink. And so what we're to do is to not waver, stay with the word of God, because God is faithful. So hold fast to the profession of your faith. Don't let anything else come out of your mouth. Don't let anything else. Put a watch over your mouth that you might not sin against him. Don't let anything else come out of your mouth. Because death and life are in what? The power of the tongue. Don't let anything else come out of your mouth. Say what the word of God says. Don't say the circumstances. Don't say contrary thoughts and contrary feelings. Well, verse 35 says similar. Cast not away, therefore, your confidence, which hath great recompense of reward. Don't cast away your confidence. So you could. This tells you not to. It wouldn't need to tell you not to unless you could. So I can cast away my confidence. I can. You can cast away your confidence. You can. And if you do, don't go blaming God. Well, it was his time. And I hear that oh so much. I want to shake people sometimes, get this religion out of them. Well, it's in God's time and God's in control. And if you get to know them and you know something about how they're talking and how they're living, how they're believing, they cast away their confidence. And you don't have to. The Bible tells us not to. Some people do, but this tells me not to. If you do cast away your confidence, thank God you can get it back. You can get it back. Thank God you can get it back. I can hold fast to the profession of my faith. Even if I've let it slip away, I can get it back and now hold it fast. If I've taken a step back, I can catch it. Say, I'm going to stop that. I'm going to stop this wavering business. I'm going to stop this staggering business. I'm not going to stagger at the promise of God through unbelief anymore. I'm not going to waver. I'm going to stop this wavering business. And I'm going to stay with what God has promised and stop looking at the circumstances. Now, this is part of the message that I preach and teach again and again. And one reason is because the Lord told me to. And I've wanted sometimes to go a different direction. I was in one service one time and I'd preached that Sunday morning and I had something else that Sunday night. And I was preparing for something else. And the Spirit of God spoke to my heart that afternoon, to continue with the same, part two of this morning, make it a part two. And on the inside, I'm saying to the Lord, well, I was going to go a different direction. And I heard, stay where I put you, son. I heard that. Stay where I put you, son. It's wrong to just try to copy somebody else or do your own thing, or you see something and I want to do that too. Whatever the reason is, we need to stay where God put us. Is that right or not? And so this is something that was in my heart, I guess, 30, 35 years ago. 30, 35, 40 years ago, I was praying for the sick and seeing people healed instantly. And I haven't even had an aspirin since January of 1980. Some people think by that I've not had any difficulties. I've not had any challenges. But we've had opportunities in our lives to go to the emergency room. I think people in the world would. But you just stand on the word of God and it's always worked, always brought results. But see, almost always... Now, early on, I would receive some instant healings, but I'd pray for other people and they'd be healed instantly. But almost always, my healings were progressive over some time, maybe a day or two or three. And then sometimes it got to where some things were longer than that. And I thought, genuinely, I thought something was wrong with me. And I know not everyone does this, but it was important to me. I fasted and prayed about it. I fasted for 3 days. This is probably 35 years ago. And the third day of a fast, I'll never forget it. I'll remember where I was. I can see myself in my mind's eye where I was, what room I was in, what I was sitting with my head down on the desk. I wasn't bowing. I do like to bow and pray. But I wasn't bowing. I was sitting in an office chair with my head down on the desk. You know, with my arms folded, my head down. You know how you might do when you're in school. And they'd say, everybody take a nap. Or the teacher stepped out. And you're going to fold your arms, put your head down on the desk. That's the position I was in. And this is the third day, the afternoon of the third day of a fast where I'm praying and asking the Lord, what's wrong with me? Where am I missing it? Other people get healed instantly and I don't. Why? Where am I missing it? What am I doing wrong? Where am I missing it? And I'm fasted the first day. I'm praying in tongues some. I didn't hear anything. The second day, I'm praying about it. Lord, where am I missing this? I almost never get healed instantly. I almost never do. Why? Other people, I pray for them and they'll testify it left. It's gone. I'm better. And praise God. But I didn't have that testimony very often. I thought something was wrong with me. And the second day, I'm praying. Some praying in tongues. And I didn't hear anything. The third day, that afternoon, and I'm sitting there in the chair, and I've got my hands folded and my head down on my hands on the desk. And I heard the Spirit of God speak to me in ways that I didn't often. And he said, progressive healings are the result of and lead to a godly life. I'm right there at the desk. I got a pen and paper and wrote it down. I'd never heard anybody say that. Found out later that John G. Lake had come across that revelation. But I'd never heard anybody say that. But I wrote it down. Progressive healings are the result of and lead to a godly life. John G. Lake had said in some people's lives, he had experienced that instant healings to some people were a curse because they'd get healed instantly and then go away and forget God. But the people that would get healed over time, He and others would talk about gradual healings. Well, the Spirit of God spoke to me and said progressive, so that's how I've said it over the years. But a gradual healing. That it keeps people hungry for God, seeking God. And then when you receive the healing, you got it with your faith and your persistence. And you'll keep it because there is an enemy that comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Very often, people who receive instant healings a few weeks or a few months later, they've lost it because there's an enemy that comes to steal it. They didn't get it on their faith, and so they don't know how to keep it. And very often, people who are healed through a special ministry, special manifestation, gifts of the Spirit, or somebody else's faith, if they don't grow, they lose it. Very often. Very often. And so I heard that, and I began to see that this is part of what the Lord wants me to teach, a part of my ministry. So I have. And it seems it's been a great blessing to people because the Christian that is growing or should be growing is not going to receive instant healings as much as they did when they first got saved. And if you aren't taught how to hook in there with the Word of God and stand your ground, you won't receive your healing. You'll go from here to there to the other place trying to get healed. Somebody will have what they say is a word of knowledge. And yeah, that's me. But 2 or 3 days later, or something real small or what. And some things can encourage your faith and you reach out and receive by your own faith because you were encouraged. And it was like a stimulant. It stimulated your faith. But the mighty works, great things of God, don't often come this way. Susan and I were watching a video one time of a large ministry, and 2 or 3 of these ministries had gotten together for this convention, and one was preaching, and the other he would come up, and they were speaking prophecy. They called it prophecy. These are big names. I won't mention the names. Everybody in the room would know who they are. And they began to have what they thought they called word of knowledge. Now this is a convention, And about everybody there, I suppose the vast majority of the people were mature Christians, been saved, filled with the Spirit, in the ministry themselves for many years. And there they are. I mean, the place is full of these people. And we're watching this video, and he begins to operate. And again, I'm not meaning to be critical, and yet there's something about me that does desire to stop wrong teaching and the misunderstanding, because they're doing good works in their own right in certain places, especially when they're going to new people evangelistically, other countries. You're preaching the gospel to new people that have never heard it. You're going to have signs, wonders, and mighty deeds. Thank God for it. But when you're teaching the church of the Lord Jesus Christ and they're not receiving their healing and you don't know why, you keep doing the same things over and over and over again that don't work. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? So Susan and I were watching this video, and they begin to operate. Both of them, he'd have it, then he'd have it. And then one would have it, and the other would have it. Well, the Lord just showed me that backs are being healed. The Lord just showed me that lungs are being healed. The Lord just showed me legs are being healed. The Lord just showed me stomachs are being healed. The Lord just showed me anybody with any problem with their head from the neck up. Yeah. Oh, yes, I see it too. Any problem with the head, the neck up, it's being healed. Well, that includes ears and eyes and nose and mouth. And after we watched it, I said to Susan, after they were finished, I said to Susan, I think they covered every part of the body there is. I mean, we went from the head to the toe. Anybody with leg problems is being healed right now. Anyone with arm problems is being healed right now. And I said to Susan, I think they pretty much covered the whole body. Everybody in the place was healed because he covered every, I said to Susan, I think he covered every, both of them together, covered every part of the body. And then I said to her, but watch, not one confirmation, nobody comes up to takes the microphone and gives a testimony. Not one. One person came up and the testimony was so convoluted, it was confusing, and it wasn't even what he was calling out. And that was the only testimony they had. And I said to Susan, that's what's out there. These are big name ministries. And I said to Susan, that's what's out there. They're not getting people healed, but they're there hearing a word of what they call as a word of knowledge. To me, that's sad. That's sad. I heard about a man. Some of you have heard this story. He had this condition. He lived in the Midwest. He went to church. He thought he was a Christian, but he really wasn't. But he had a condition that came up, and the doctor said, you need to get to a different climate where there's less humidity, drier air. You need to go get to the west. So he moved to the Los Angeles area, and the same time that Amy Simple McPherson was starting a church. So he got into her meetings and heard about healing and received his healing and was healed. He received an instant healing, joined her church, and was faithful going to church there 10 years. He received his healing, and now he's a member of her church for 10 years. Then he got a transfer on the job, and he moved in North California. He moved further north, Lodi area, California. And after some years after being there, he developed a double hernia. So he said to himself, well, I'm going to get back down to Los Angeles, Sister McPherson's meetings, and get in the prayer line and let her pray for me and get healed. So he got a train ticket, took two weeks off work and went to Los Angeles. Now you had to listen to the day teaching services in order to get a prayer card. So he went through the day teaching services to get a prayer card, to get in the prayer line at night, to have Sister McPherson pray for him. So he did that. She prayed for him and nothing happened. And he thought, well, I guess anybody can have a bad night. So I'm going to get in the prayer line again. Well, you've got to go through the day teaching services. So he did that. He went through the day teaching services, got another prayer card, and got in the prayer line and let Sister McPherson pray for him a second time. And nothing happened. So his 2 weeks, you know, is up. He took 2 weeks off work. He's got to get back to work. So he gets on the train, comes back to Lodi, and he has a double hernia. And he begins to think, well, Sister McPherson used to have it, but she lost it. I remember when she prayed for me and I got healed, but she doesn't have it anymore. She used to have the healing anointing. She doesn't have it anymore. She lost it. Well, old Roberts in time came to the area. He had heard of his ministry. So he got in those meetings. And old Roberts prayed for him and nothing happened. So he said to himself, well, old Roberts said he had it, but he doesn't have it. Now, Sister McPherson used to have it, but she lost it. Well, it wasn't long after that, you know, another year or so went by, and William Branham came to the area, and he had heard of his vision, his testimony. Well, I'm going to get in his meeting. So William Branham prayed for him. Nothing happened. So he said to himself, well, William Branham doesn't have it. He said he had it, but he doesn't have it. Old Robert said he had it, but he doesn't have it. Now, Sister McPherson used to have it, but she lost it. Well, A.A. Allen came to town, and he got in those meetings. Nothing happened. Well, A.A. Allen said he had it, but he doesn't have it. William Branham said he has it, but he doesn't have it. Old Robert says he has it, but he doesn't have it. Now, Sister McPherson used to have it, but she lost it. And I think maybe Jack Coe came to the area too, but Kenneth Hagin came. And Kenneth Hagin prayed for him twice, and nothing happened. But he came up to Kenneth Hagin and said, Brother Hagin, can I speak to you? Told him all this story. And said, and you prayed for me twice and nothing happened. You know, you said you had it. I heard about your experience where Jesus appeared to you and laid the finger of his right hand into the palms of each of your hands and the healing anointing. And so I went in your healing line. You prayed for me twice and nothing happened. And I began to say, well, Brother Hagin said he had it, but he doesn't have it. A. Allen said he has it, but he doesn't have it. William Branham said he had it, but he doesn't have it. Oral Roberts said he had it, but he doesn't have it. And Sister McPherson used to have it, but she lost it. But he said to Brother Hagin, he said, but I'm beginning to see something. I go, I've been going to the day teaching services and hearing you teach in the daytime, and I'm beginning to see something is required of me. God is not going to heal me the way he did way back then when I first got healed under Sister McPherson's ministry. And see, that's been many years ago. And I'm beginning to learn God's expecting something of me. So I'm going to just take your teaching to heart and learn it and act upon it and feed on it and do it. Well, the next year, Brother Hagin was in that area again. And he came to the meeting and said, Brother Hagin, can I speak to you? Do you remember me? Let me tell you what happened. Last year you were here. You laid hands on me twice. Nothing happened. But I began to get a hold of your teaching, listening to your teaching. And here's what I've done. After you left, now he was wearing a brace for the double hernia. But he said, I began to realize I have to believe I've received my healing by faith and not by how I feel and what I see. And so I'd wear the brace because I needed it. You know, physically, it was a physical aid and assistant to me. So I'd wear the brace, but at night when I'd take it off, lay it there by the bed, I'd say to the brace, you're temporary. I believe healing is working in my body. In the morning when I'd get up, I'd put that brace on, but I'd say to the brace, you're temporary. And I'd tell the Lord, I believe healing is working in my body. And I'd praise the Lord during the day. I'd praise the Lord that healing is working in my body. Lord, thank you. Healing is working in my body. I believe I have received my healing by whose stripes I was healed. Himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. The healing anointing has been administered to me. Hands have been laid upon me. I've received that by faith. Healing is working in me regardless of what I feel, regardless of what I see. I thank you for it. At night, he'd take the brace off, lay it there by the bed to get in bed, and he'd say to the brace, you're temporary. And he'd say to the Lord, I believe healing's working in me. Thank you, healing is working in me. And he said to Brother Hagin, I did that for 3 months and didn't see any change at all. But I didn't waver. I didn't stagger. Now, he could have said that because that's what he did. That's what he's saying. I don't know if those are exact the words that he said to Brother Hagin, but it could be because that's what he did. Are you listening to me? I didn't waver. I didn't stagger. I did that for 3 months, didn't see any change. Then after 3 months, I began to notice gradually the hernias were shrinking. And I'd say to myself, you know, they're going down. They're getting smaller. And I continued to do that. You're temporary. I tell the brace, you're temporary. Thank you, Lord. Healing is working in me. Thank you, Lord, by whose stripes I was healed. Thank you. You took my infirmities and bore my sicknesses. Jesus Christ maketh me whole. You sent your word and healed me. Hands were laid upon me and I'm recovering. According to the word of God, I'm well. Thank you that I'm well. Thank you, healing is working in me. He'd wear the brace. He'd tell the brace, you're temporary. But he'd say, these hernias are shrinking. They're not as large as they used to be. And he continued to do that another 3 months. So now a total of 6 months, first 3 months, no change at all. Couldn't see any change. Another 3 months, little by little, gradual, progressive, there are results. And then he says, they're all gone. Don't need the hernia. Don't need the brace anymore. The double hernia is gone. After 6 months, totally disappeared. He said to Brother Hagin, you know what I'm doing now? I'm going out. See, I retired. I'm not at work anymore. I'm going out during the day and just going through the neighborhood and asking, any sick here? Any sick here? And I'm praying for the sick. During the day, I'm knocking on doors. Any sick here? And I'm praying for the sick, sharing with them the word of God, telling them what Jesus has done for them. You know, I'm not a detriment. I'm an asset. I'm working for the kingdom of God. I've received, freely I've received, and freely I'm giving. And how I've received healing, I'm testifying and tell others. I'm telling others. Amen. Well, Sister McPherson didn't lose it. Oral Roberts did have it. William Branham did have it. A.A. Allen did have it. Brother Hagin did have it. But for some people, God wants them to receive by their faith, and something is required of them. God wants us to grow. Can you say amen, somebody? Some of you have heard this story. I like telling this story. There was a man back in the 20s. He was an evangelist. He had been preaching and evangelizing, going from church to church. Sinners are getting saved. People are being filled with the Holy Ghost. People are being healed in his meetings. And he came down with tuberculosis. It was the number two killer in those days. Well, when he realized and diagnosed that he has this disease, he goes to meetings. Smith Wigglesworth prayed for him. Lillian B. Yeomans prayed for him. Dr. P.C. Nelson prayed for him. Raymond T. Ritchie prayed for him. And then I heard Brother Hagin tell this story another time, and he said he thinks Charles S. Price also prayed for him. But you've got these four and possibly the fifth. Smith Wigglesworth laid hands on him and prayed for him. Nothing happened. Dr. Lillian B. Yeomans prayed for him. Nothing happened. Raymond T. Ritchie prayed for him. Nothing happened. Dr. P.C. Nelson, he would anoint with oil. That's how he got healed, so that's how he ministered healing, with anointing oil. He anointed him with oil and prayed for him. Nothing happened. And so he's getting worse. Well, he's still traveling at first, going from church to church to church. And when he's there preaching in the church, he'd tell the pastor and tell the congregation, and this is what was done, still done. You see this. The pastor would have all the church come gather around him and pray. And they'd lay hands, you know, the ones that could reach him. And if you're in the back, you'd lay hands on the person that's laying hands on the person that's laying hands on the person. And the whole church is gathered around, laying hands. And the pastor is praying. And the church is praying. And he'd go to another church, and he'd have them come gather around him and pray. And he'd go to another church. And then he got weaker and weaker and couldn't travel anymore. Ended up staying with his parents on their farm. One day, they're off farming somewhere, and he's in the house, and he's alone in the house. And he's emaciated and just wasting away and nearly dead. And he's there laying in the bed, and he sees through the window a grove of trees. And he begins to think to himself, and he says, Lord, if you'll help me, if you'll give me the strength to get out of this bed and get to that grove of trees, just look so peaceful. If I could get to that grove of trees, I'm just going to get there and I'm going to pray. And Lord, I'm going to pray. If you'll give me the strength to get to that grove of trees, I'm going to pray until you heal me or until I die. I was telling this story one time, and a lady to my left about halfway back the church said, amen. And I thought to myself, that's what you would do. But you listen to the rest of the story and it would be the wrong thing. But she said right out loud, everybody heard her. Amen. Because that's the mentality that a lot of church people have. I'm going to pray until you heal me. See, it's future tense, future tense, future tense. I'm going to pray until you heal me or until I die. And aren't you impressed by my tenacity? Aren't you impressed? You know, it's like they're trying to impress God. I'm just going to buckle in there and I'm determined. I'm going to pray until you heal me, even if it kills me. I'm going to pray until you heal me, even if it kills me. I'm going to pray until you heal me, even if it kills me. They got such determination. And so he got out of the bed and took all the strength he had to get to that grove of trees. And by the time he got there, he's so weak, he can barely whisper, can barely lift his hand. I mean, he's crawling to finally get there. But he finally got to that grove of trees. And then when he got out there, he began to think. Thank God he began to think. He began to think. You know, Lord, I said I was going to come out here and pray until you healed me or until I died. But you know what? If prayer was going to do it, it'd already be done. If praying until you healed me is what's going to get you to heal me, I'd already be healed. If prayer was going to do it, if prayer was going to do it, it'd already have done it. He began to think. Raymond T. Ritchie prayed for me. Nothing happened. Dr. P.C. Nelson prayed for me. Lillian P. Omens prayed for me. Smith Wigglesworth prayed for me. And then all of these churches. And then they're continuing to pray. You know, if they had email, they'd send an email. We're still praying for you, brother. If they had text, then they send a text. Well, we're still praying. Well, the doctor says I still have it. Everybody keep praying. Isn't that the kind of text that's going back and forth? Why, where have we missed it? That's what's out there. Everybody keep praying. The doctor says, I still have it. If they had texting, this is back in the 20s, but if they had texting, he would have had thousands of texts. We're praying for you, brother. Y'all keep praying. Everybody keep praying. And he began to think there at that grove of trees, you know what, there's thousands of people praying for me. All those churches. He remembered them gathering round about him. He'd go to another church. He remembered them gathering round about him. He'd go to another church. He remembered them gathering round about him praying. And he said, Lord, I'm not going to pray anymore. If prayer was going to do it, if prayer was going to do it, it'd be done. I'm not going to pray. I know I said I would, but I'm not going to. Now, I know praise is prayer. It's a kind of prayer. But here's what he said. I'm going to praise you. I'm just going to take you at your word. You said in your word, by whose stripes I was healed. That's past tense. It's already done. I'm just going to take you at your word. You said you took my infirmities and bore my sicknesses. That's something that's already done. I'm just going to take you at your word. And I'm not going to ask you to do something that your word says is already done. I'm going to thank you for it. I'm going to praise you for it. And he began to do that at that grove of trees. Now, the devil had already told him how foolish he was. You're just a fool now. You said you're going to pray until God healed you, until you died, and that's exactly what's going to happen. You're going to die out here. Your family will come back from their farming and they're working in the fields and not know where you are. They're going to go through the house and where are you? You're gone. They're not going to know that you're out here at this grove of trees. The devil said to him, the only way your family is ever going to find you is the buzzards circling the air. They're going to know where you are by the buzzards coming to your dead body. That's how your family will find you. You're going to die out here. The devil was fighting him. Don't you tell me the devil won't fight you. Thoughts have to be cast down. Thoughts have to be brought into captivity. You have to deal with your mind. Don't tell me you don't. You have to deal with your mind. The devil said, you're going to die out here. But he said, Lord, I'm going to take you at your word. And he began to praise the Lord. At first, he started with a whisper. Lord, I just praise you for my healing. praise you. Lord, I praise you for my healing. He just started with the whisper, Lord, I praise you for my healing. I believe I'm healed. I thank you. I thank you I'm healed. Lord, I praise you for my healing. And then he got a little stronger and the voice got a little stronger. Then he's raising his hands. He's got enough strength to raise his hands. Lord, I just praise you for my healing. Thank you by whose stripes I was healed. I believe I've received. Healing is working in me. You sent your word. I'm taking you at your word. He's raising his hands and now praising God for his healing. And he did that. His voice got a little stronger. His voice got a little louder. His hands got a little higher. He stood up. Now he's standing with his arms in the air and his hands in the air. He did this for an hour and a half. And every symptom left. He went back to some of the same churches and gave his testimony and told them how he received his healing. And he taught and he preached and he explained it was not just prayer. It's when I took God at his word. Can you say amen, somebody? Let me tell this story too, and I'll close with this. There's a lady in England, a young lady. She was crippled. Nearly paralyzed, maybe from the waist down. She had some feeling, but she's crippled, paralyzed, has no use, real use of her legs from the waist down. But she read in the Bible, in the book of James, call for the elders of the church and they'll come and pray over you, anointing you with oil. The prayer of faith will heal. The word save there means heal the sick. The Lord shall raise them up. So she called for the church. And the person that answered, the pastor said, we don't believe that. The pastor doesn't believe in that. Well, she was a little disheartened. She got a phone call back and the assistant pastor said, I'll come. The pastor wouldn't come, but the assistant pastor said, I'll come. So he came to her home, anointed her with oil, according to James in chapter 5. The prayer of faith will heal the sick. Save there, and the Greek means heal. After he anointed her with oil and prayed for her healing, he left. There's no change. But she would tell visitors. She told her family. She told people that visited. She would say, get my Bible there. Open it to James 5, 14, 15. Read it there. And then she'd say, this has been done to me. I've been anointed with oil. This has been done with me. To me. This has been done to me. And she'd tell other people, they'd visit her. She'd say, get my Bible right there and open it to James chapter 5, verse 14. This has been done to me. I've been anointed with oil. The prayer of faith has been prayed. The Lord's raising me up. This has been done to me. She didn't try to get it done again. She didn't try to get somebody else to come pray a better prayer. She'd tell everyone that would listen, this has been done to me. Past tense, it's been done. And the Lord's raising me up. Well, 6 months, she had sort of a seizure and got worse. But for 6 months, think of it, for six months, she's no better. But she didn't waver. She didn't stagger at the promise of God through unbelief. Everything that came out of her mouth as a testimony to others was, this has been done to me. By the word of God. The word of God is true, and I've acted upon the word, and this has been done to me. I've been anointed with oil. The prayer of faith has been prayed. This has been done. 6 months, she had a seizure. She's worse. She's now doubled over with pain. She can't use her legs, but there's still some feeling because she has pain. And her mother was just weeping and crying and begging and pleading. This is my baby. This is my baby girl. Now, she's not a baby. She's in her teens, I think, early teens, maybe 13. I don't remember. But the mother's just pleading with God, seeing the anguish that's on her baby girl. 6 months, she had a seizure. She's worse. But she would still say, drawn up with pain, she would still say, get my Bible right there and open it to James 5:14. This has been done to me. The Lord's raising me up. I've had the prayer of faith prayed. I've been anointed with oil. Look what it says. Call for the elders of the church. I did that. They'll come and pray, anointing you with oil, and the prayer of faith will heal the sick. This has been done to me. This has been done. She wanted others to believe with her. They didn't. She wanted others to rejoice with her. They didn't. She wanted others to praise God with her. They didn't. But she didn't waver. Another 3 months went by, and Jesus Christ appeared to her and said, I'm the Lord that strengtheneth thee. I think that's what he said. I'm the Lord that strengtheneth thee. And every part of her body was made whole. She got up out of the bed. Jesus was no longer there, but she's standing by her bed, completely made whole. And she calls out in the British way, Mom! Mom! Or Mummy. Mom! And she comes to the door. Her mother comes to the door and opens the bedroom door and sees her daughter standing fully erect there by the bed. Her mother sees her daughter completely healed and completely well standing there by the bed. And her mother faints. This has been done to me. And she stood her ground for 9 months. Hold fast to the profession of your faith without wavering, for God is faithful. Can you say amen?